see. I was thinking as you said that, Jamie. At a very young age, probably, interestingly, and then into college, there was a sense that I had of contributing in some way to making, you know, the world a better place. And so that just sort of carried through my thinking. So after a couple of years in the private sector, after graduating from college, I started a not-for-profit in New York City. And it came out of some experiences where I had difficulty volunteering. I went out to try and volunteer in the community and actually couldn't do it. I went to about six organizations to teach adults how to read, you know, adult literacy, and it was very difficult. And so therein lay the seeds of an idea and created a not-for-profit organization to help get young professionals involved in the community. Well, we did some innovative things, and that organization was looked at as a model for rolling out nationally. And that was my first experience with the idea of growth and replication and scale, but we couldn't do it for a lot of the reasons I think organizations today, even though we had some key supporters, are still running into the same obstacles. And so fast forward through a business school and then a management consulting stint where I learned an awful lot about organizational management, both in business school and as a consultant, and then was fortunate enough to be asked to run a small venture capital firm. And that gave me a lot of additional experiences and expertise around growth companies, investing, bringing together collaborative capital, etc. And I was lucky to meet a like-minded individual who I met in that field, and we saw a lot of folks with significant means, and yet individuals that made, you know, themselves very wealthy, and yet, and some of them, not all, certainly not all, maybe half, maybe fewer, were really interested in doing something significant to help their communities, but they didn't know how. So that was the, you know, the seeds of the idea. Well, gosh, I wonder if organizations today are still having difficulty getting the capital they need, like I had, to grow. I wonder if the individuals that have significant means can get matched up with them in a more efficient manner, since they didn't seem to know exactly where to give. They always gave to their alma maters, generally, and to their, you know, the group down the street. But beyond that, they didn't really know. So we did about 2 years of research. We didn't realize it was going to be 2 years of research. But, you know, we did 6 months of talking to senior heads of foundations and philanthropists and people across the country and asked them, is this still a problem? And everybody came back literally and said, this is a huge problem. And Jamie's former boss, Mike Balin, was very instrumental in our thinking and very helpful, and as others were. So then we said, instead of jumping right in, we said, well, why? I won't go bore you with all the details, but we spent another year and a half figuring out, well what's the problem? How can't get these organizations to scale if everybody says this is a real missing piece in the sector? And we developed a systems kind of approach to the whole piece, which is both to serve as an intermediary, what we call a growth capital intermediary, doing some of the similar work and building on the real groundbreaking work of organizations like the Robin Hood Foundation and Edna McConnell Clark, where you really vet an organization to see if it's really effective, you help them prepare a business plan. But then we realized the hard part was, or a part that hadn't been really cracked, was the capital piece. So we developed a collaborative syndicating capital model where we take the plan out to folks. There were no folks to take it out to, though. So we had to spend another year and a half developing at least an initial set of funders. So an investment bank has their set of individual investors and their institutional investors, and they take a private placement memorandum or a company that they're trying to raise money for, and they go to their network of investors. Well, those investors didn't exist. I mean, you had a couple of leading foundations, like the Clark Foundation, and, you know, a couple of others that did some growth funding. By and large, there was no growth capital. And so we built an initial network that also included groups that aggregated families, philanthropic families. And now we're starting with our first four organizations. And we've completed the business plans. We don't do the business plans. We hire others. and we started to raise the initial money. The second thing we do, though, is we realized we needed to build that intermediary model and prove some success. But we're really trying ultimately to build a system, a marketplace, where organizations can consistently attract this capital, and not just our own organizations, ones that Edna McConnell Clark works with and others. So we're really trying to, our ultimate mission is to build a system, a marketplace, a capital marketplace in the not-for-profit sector, so the capital can flow. And we can talk more about that as we go forward. But that, to us, is really the ultimate goal.